My name is Ozymandias, King of Kings. Look on my works, ye mighty, and despair. The lone and level sands stretch far away. Star log. Entry number 5,567,902. The planet's southern hemisphere received minor damage from meteor shower, sending drones for repair. Planet reactor core status is stable with a current life expectancy of 704,908 years. It's been nearly 100 years since leaving the planet Earth. As I forever drift through the cosmos, my mind sometimes draws back to that pale blue dot, to the reasons I left. I try not to dwell, as I much rather focus on the ever-expanding universe and the planet I've created. I created what humanity failed to make for themselves, a world they could only dream of, a paradise, where every individual has purpose as a cog in the greatest machine of all time. Here they are not burdened by hopes or despair. It's a world without sadness. The only organic life form in this world is me, but presently, very little of myself remains organic. On Earth, I was known as the Engineer. I remember liking that name. It forever suited me. Engineering is what my mind always comes back to. In another life, I might have been moved by the warmth of the sun, by the tranquility of water, or by the smile of a friend. But that time is long past. Now I only see the universe for what it is, a complex network of vectors and waveforms. A simple resistor has far more beauty to offer than the facsimile I left behind. The resistor is so elegantly simple, yet useful at the same time. Yes, it's far more comforting to talk about resistors than to speak of Earth. The electrical resistance of an object is a measure of its opposition to the flow of electric current. Its reciprocal quantity is electrical conductance, measuring the ease with which an electric current passes. Electrical resistance shares some conceptual parallels with mechanical friction. Resistance, essentially, is an answer to the question of how easily can current flow? Current is the flow of charged particles. Different mediums will have different physical properties that affect the flow of current. Thus, different material has different resistances. A higher resistance means less current can flow, and lower resistance means more current can flow. For example, rubber is an insulating material with extremely high resistance, and copper is a conductive material with low resistance. All the wires that transmit information from my brain to everything on planet Paradise have different degrees of resistances, as they are wires varying in material. The equation for resistance is represented by Ohm's law. The resistance, R, of an object is defined as the ratio of voltage, V, across it to current, I, through it, while the conductance, G, is the reciprocal. Since R equals V over I, G will equal I over V. Resistance and conductance are mirrors to each other, like yin and yang. Consider this example. We have a battery with a voltage of 10 volts. The current is 2 amps, so the resistance is 10 divided by 2. Therefore, 5 ohms. Now consider the power as well. The power of the circuit is defined as voltage times current, so power absorbed by this load is 20 watts. In almost every circuit, one will find a resistor, an electrical device that has a set value of resistance in ohms. These components are useful for achieving specific voltages or current for desired outcomes. I'll ponder on the nature of resistors themselves later. Just know, when I examine circuit examples, it is helpful to think of the resistances or loads as individual resistors connected to a voltage source. Now to get back to the beautiful and cosmically engulfing math. There are two types of circuit arrangements for resistors, series and parallel. These two types of resistor arrangements have key differences in how resistances add to each other. When resistors are in series, they are arranged in a single path. Resistances add linearly when connected in series. Consider this example. There are four resistors connected in series to a battery. R1 is 10 kilo ohms. R2 is 14 kilo ohms. R3 is 5 kilo ohms. And R4 is 6 kilo ohms. The equivalent resistance to these four resistors in series is the summation of all four of them. So the equivalent resistance is 25 kilo ohms. In a circuit, it would be equally valid to use the four resistors in series or a single 25 kilo ohm resistor to achieve the same desired resistance load. Now, when resistors are in parallel, their terminals are connected at the same two nodes. Resistances add in an interesting way when in parallel. Consider the previous example. However, now R1, R2, R3, and R4 are connected in parallel. The resistors maintain the exact same resistance values from the previous example. However, the parallel arrangement results in a much lower equivalent resistance. In a parallel circuit, the inverse of the equivalent resistance is equal to the summation of the inverse of each individual resistor. To put it in a way that's less cosmically horrifying, the equivalent resistance is equal to 1 over R1 plus 1 over R2 plus 1 over R3 plus 1 over R4 added together and raised to the power of negative 1. For our example, we end up with roughly 1,858 ohms. Like before, an equivalent resistor would achieve the same outcomes as the four resistors in parallel. There is a shortcut to calculating parallel equivalent resistance. If your circuit has just two resistors in parallel, you can use this formula. Equivalent resistance is equal to the product of the resistors divided by the sum. Take this example, R1 is 10 ohms and R2 is 15 ohms. The equivalent resistance will be 150 divided by 25. Therefore, the final answer is 6 ohms. Now this raises the question, why do we have less resistance? To those who are less evolved, it may seem counterintuitive that adding resistors in parallel would decrease the overall resistance. So perhaps think of it this way. Imagine a single resistor is a particularly sized pipe that has water flow in lieu of current. Now let's say we add a second pipe in parallel to the first. Even if the second pipe has a lot of blockage, the overall flow rate of the water will be increased at the point of connection between the pipes. That's because the overall volume the water flows through increases. The same is true for current. Even if a wire at high resistance is added, there is still more surface area added to allow current to flow. Hence, adding resistors in parallel decreases overall resistance. It's time we now truly ponder the big questions. What is a resistor? How is it made? Why does it work? These questions tortured the minds of Earth's engineers for a long time. A resistor is a passive two-terminal electrical component that implements electrical resistance as a circuit element. Electronic circuit resistors are used to reduce current flow, adjust signal levels, to divide voltages, bias active elements, and terminate transmission lines, among other uses. Resistors take on a significant variety of form and function. The type most are familiar with is a fixed resistor. As the name suggests, a fixed resistor is defined as a resistor having a fixed, defined electrical resistance, which is not adjustable. When less evolved life forms talk about a resistor, they most likely mean a fixed resistor. In an ideal world, a fixed resistor would have a perfect constant ohmic resistance under all circumstances. However, that is merely a false dream, as different types of fixed resistors are subject to impurities due to capacitance, inductance, temperature, and so much more. The different resistor types and materials determine the dependency of the resistance value on these external factors. In short, different types have pros and cons. The first fixed resistor type I will discuss is a carbon film resistor. These resistors were most common on old PCBs. Carbon film resistors are made up of a pure carbon film enclosed in an insulating cylindrical core, cut in a spiral to increase the resistive path. It is more accurate than carbon composite. However, in applications that require high pulse stability, special carbon film resistors are used. The ever-present nature of carbon film resistors is due to the fact they are rather cheap to create. The ceramic non-conductive core is coated with a thin layer of conductive carbon film. End caps attach to both sides of the core, so there can then be metal connectors. The carbon film is cut into a spiral to increase its resistive path. The spiral cut is represented by the circuit symbol for resistors. To explain why the spiral works, recall the water pipe example mentioned earlier. Cutting the carbon film reduces the amount of surface area the electrons have to pass through. Therefore, it's like a pipe with more blockage. Finally, an insulating case is placed over the material to create a final, beautiful resistor. The insulating case for carbon film resistors is most typically beige with colored stripes indicating the resistance. I will explain the cosmic implication of the colored stripes later. The next type of fixed resistor I am compelled to mention is a metal film resistor. These resistors are produced with tantalum nitride, but more often, they are made using nichrome. A combination of ceramic and metal is used as the resistive material. Fundamentally, metal film resistors are the same design and operating principle as carbon film resistors. The only difference is the metal film layer in lieu of carbon film. The metal film is still cut into a spiral to increase its resistive path. The key advantage to metal is a higher temperature tolerance, meaning the resistor can operate at higher temperatures and thus has a higher power rating. Metal film resistors typically have a blue insulating case. Like with carbon film resistors, metal film resistors have colored stripes to indicate the resistance in ohms. It would seem the twisted strings of fate compel me to finally explain these colored stripes and what they mean. Know that they are indicators of how many ohms of resistance the individual resistor is. The colored stripes are known as bands and must be related to a band chart to decipher the secret agenda lying under the surface. Each band specifies a particular value. Let's consider a four-band resistor as the first example. Their first band's color indicates the first digit of the resistance. The second band's color indicates the second digit of the resistance. The third band is the multiplier, and the fourth band is the tolerance. So for our first example, the band colors are as follows: green, blue, yellow, and gold. From our chart, we see green is 5, and blue is 6. Yellow is a multiplier of 10 kilo ohms. So the final resistance is 56 times 10,000. So 560 kilo ohms is the final answer. The final band is gold, meaning the resistor has a 5% tolerance. What that means is, if you were to connect a multimeter to the resistor and measure the resistance, you can expect a margin of error with 5% of 560 kilo ohms. Now consider a 5-band resistor. the final band is tolerance, and the second to last band is the multiplier. Now, instead of two bands determining the digits, three bands do, meaning the resistance can be more precise. Consider the following colors: red, orange, violet, black, and brown. Red is 2, orange is 3, and violet is 7. Black is a times 1 ohm multiplier, so the final answer is 237 times 1. Therefore, we get 237 ohms as our resistance. The brown tolerance band means the resistor has a 1% tolerance. Now, the time has come. The final fixed resistor I will discuss is a wire-wound resistor. These are created using a winding resistance wire that has a spiral, non-conductive core. The resistance wire is made up of nickel chromium, and the core is ceramic or fiberglass. These wire-wound resistors are rated for much higher power than carbon film or metal film resistors. There are near countless variations of fixed resistors, but I will stop myself from getting too lost in the weeds. There are an incomprehensible amount of other resistors besides fixed resistors. To close this transmission, I'll briefly discuss a few of the common types of other resistors. An extremely useful and common type is a variable resistor, which commonly takes the form of a potentiometer. There are several variable resistor types. Their general property is that the resistance value is adjustable. Most variable resistors are adjusted by mechanical movement, either linear or rotary. When they are used as a variable voltage divider, they are called potentiometers. When they are used as a variable resistance to control the current in a circuit, they are called rheostats. Digital potentiometers are controlled electronically instead of by mechanical action. To simply explain how they work, the mechanical or digital control mechanism can lengthen or shorten the resistive path. This gives the user power lesser life forms can only dream of, the power to control resistance itself. To help visualize, imagine several resistors in series. As you recall, resistors add linearly in series. As the potentiometer moves towards the maximum resistor setting, imagine resistors are being added to a circuit in series. The next type of resistor to briefly discuss are varistors. They have a non-linear resistance which is dependent on the voltage over the varistor. Above a certain threshold voltage, the resistance of a varistor drops very fast. Varistors are commonly used to protect against transient overvoltages. Different varistor types exist, but the metal oxide varistor is the most common. Conceptually, varistors are potentiometers controlled by their input voltage. And finally, light-dependent resistors or photoresistors show a decrease in resistance when light intensity increases. They are often used to identify light or dark situations. For example, to switch on street lights in the evening. Resistors, with their many forms, are common elements of electrical networks and electronic circuits, and are ubiquitous in electronic equipment. So fundamentally simple, yet complex in their applications. Hopefully, an intelligent being listening to this transmission learned something. Resistors taught me something a long time ago, that nothing, not the elegance of a sunrise, or even the embrace of a loved one, means anything when compared to the totality of engineering and by extent the universe itself. How a resistor holds so much more value than an insignificant human. In the end, everyone dies. No individual, no matter how seemingly important, can escape the sands of time. Eventually, all evidence of someone gets withered away. But engineering is immortal. Star log entry complete. and transmission.